Ethan, Ethan, Jason needs a battery, 9 volt. I think there's some that side, by the...
Is that
No, just bring one of those Worths.
Sorry.
And then I also don't have volume, but you might not have put that on yet. All right. Good morning, everybody. Just welcoming you here today. I have a sneaky suspicion I'm welcoming more people online than in church today. It is a cold day, but I tell you what, I wouldn't miss Pentecost Sunday for anything. And so great to be here with you guys in church this morning. And I believe more people will join us as the service goes on. But if you're at home, we just want to welcome you as well. Enjoy your cup of coffee. And remember that the Holy Spirit can meet you there and invite Him into your home as we're about to invite Him here this morning. And then I'm going to hand over to our worship team. So, Father, we come this morning. We thank You, Lord, for today, a day that You have known about, a day that You have planned. And Holy Spirit, we come here this morning and we've planned a few worship songs and we've put out the communion. We've got a scripture and partly a message this morning. But Holy Spirit, we want to welcome You in this place. We want to welcome You to come and speak to us. We want to welcome You and ask You to speak to us and tell us the secrets on our Father's heart. Holy Spirit, this morning, would You even teach us how to pray to our Father in heaven? We think about the great task that we have to spread the good news, Holy Spirit, and we realize that we need more of You. We can only do it with You. We welcome You in this place. I pray that You would be felt in every home this morning, Lord, of everybody who watches this. You are welcome in this place, and we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Can we have that first scripture? The priests and the captain of the guard, temple guard, and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. So they seized Peter and John because it was evening, and they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed, and the number of the men grew to about 5,000. The next day, the rulers and elders and teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, who was there, and so was Caiaphas and John, Alexander, and the other men of the high priest's family. And they had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them. By what power or what name do you do this? And Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a cripple, and are asked how he was healed, well then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. He is the stone that you builders rejected, which has become the capstone, and salvation is found in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. And when they saw the courage of Peter and John, they realized they were unschooled, ordinary men. They were astonished, and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. We ask for that filling of the Spirit, Lord Jesus. That filled with the Spirit, we would speak, and the people would take note that we'd been with Jesus. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free, and my shame is undone. In Your presence, Lord. Sing it together, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, You are welcome here. Come fly this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Sing, there's nothing worth more. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. 'Cause you're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. Oh, tasted and see. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. In your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Silangazelela, 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 umoyele, silangazelela, silangazelela. Silangazelela umoyo ngcwele, silangazelela, silangazelela umoyo ngcwele. Oh, we long for you. Oh, we hunger and thirst for you. We remember your words to the crowds, come to me, all you who are weary and thirsty. I will give you rest. I will give you rest. And that you would baptize us with the Holy Spirit and with fire. And that it would be a fountain of living water inside of us. Oh, I thirst for you. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place. Fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Oh, my soul cries, seek the Lord, Almighty King. Your face I seek, my soul cries, seek the Lord. Seek his face, my soul cries, seek the Lord, Almighty King. Your face I seek, my soul cries, seek the Lord. Seek his face. Seek his face. Just one thing, Lord, will I ask. And all else I'll count as loss. Let me taste and see your goodness as I dwell in your house. Let your glory wash over me. Oh Lord, my soul cries, seek the Lord, Almighty King. Your face I seek, my soul cries, seek the Lord. seek his face, my soul cries. Seek the Lord, Almighty King, your face I seek, my soul cries. Seek the Lord, seek his face. We seek your face. Yes, we seek your face. We seek your face. We seek your face. Better one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere, Lord. Better one word from your lips resting on my brokenness to draw me deeper into you. Your face I seek, my soul cries. Seek the Lord, seek his face, my soul cries. Seek the Lord, a promised peace. Your face I seek, my soul cries. Seek the Lord, seek his face. Seek your face. We seek your face. We seek your face. More than anything, we seek your face. Before all treasures, we seek your face. With the desperation, we seek your face. So we seek your face. All of creation seeks. All of creation groans. All of creation seeks. All of creation groans. Cries out to you. Holy, holy, holy. All the heavens ring with holy, holy, holy. Let the nation sing it. Holy, holy, holy. All the heavens ring with holy, holy, holy. Let the nation sing it. Holy, holy, holy. Your face I see, my soul cries. Seek the Lord, seek his face, my soul cries. Seek the Lord, promise peace. Your face I see, my soul cries. Seek the Lord, we seek your face. So we seek your face. We seek your face. We seek your face. Yes, we seek your face. More than power, more than miracles in our lives. It's your face we seek, Jesus. It's your face that we seek, Father. Fill us with the Holy Spirit so we can see you. And the overflow of our hearts will come out of our lips. And we will be your witnesses. Oh, my soul cries, seek the Lord. Oh, promised peace, your face I seek. My soul cries, seek the Lord. We seek your face, my soul cries, seek the Lord. Oh, promised peace, your face I seek. My soul cries, seek the Lord. We seek your face. We seek your face. There is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search for all eternity long, but I'd find that there is none like you. That's why we seek your face, Jesus. That's why we seek your face. You are the treasure that is hidden in the field that we sell our lives to get a hold of. We give everything, we lay everything else aside, because you are our inheritance. You are our portion. You are our satisfaction. My soul cries, I seek your face. I seek your face. We're going to take a little break now, and I just want to ask you to stay in an attitude of worship, as even as we do announcements and those things. Just stay in an attitude of worship.
Right. I knew a few more people would join us this morning, and I think when we started there was like 5 people sitting here, and so thank you guys for joining us, the rest of you. I met Vince's brother Edward this morning, and I don't think we've ever met before, hey? But welcome, Edward. And then I was wondering if there's anybody else here. It's your first time at Wellspring Ministries. You chose this chilly Sunday to grace us with your presence. Nobody else? Well, to the rest of you, welcome. I have 3 quick announcements. I know announcements is the worst part of the sermon because you have to actually remember them too. And so the first one I want to make is that next week we have our AGM. And, you know, if we could sidestep the AGM, we would. But because we're a church and we have to have a constitution, you have to have an AGM. So we do it. And so we're going to have an AGM next week, Sunday. And and as many people as we can participate in the AGM, it's going to be good. The notes for the AGM or the reports are on the backboard. Feel free to go read them. You can read about most things in the church. If you have any questions, you can ask me or one of the elders that are here this morning, and they will try and explain it to you. But they're there. And next week, we actually just take them as read because they've been on the board for over 2 weeks now. Then the other announcement is on Tuesday at 11 o'clock in church here, we're going to have a satellite service for Uncle John's memorial service or his homecoming service. So what's going to happen is the service is happening at Hatfield in Pretoria, and we will actually, it'll be streamed live onto the screen here. Arthur and Aniki will be here, and if you would like to join them here instead of making the trip up to Johannesburg or Pretoria, feel free to come and join us here on Tuesday morning at 11. Derek will actually be here hosting it here, and I will be in Pretoria. So if you want to come and support Arthur and Aniki, if you just want to remember Uncle John and celebrate his life, come and join us here. If you don't know who Uncle John is, you'll have to come and ask me afterwards. but he used to be a serving member of our congregation. So, yeah. And then my last announcement, remember there was three. So it's the AGM and Uncle John's service. And then the last one is tonight at Abundant Life Church, which we all know as the 10th church out of town. There's going to be a service at 6 o'clock. And they're basically inviting all churches. But because of COVID, we're not inviting the whole church. So we're looking for about 10 people who want to go and just represent Wellspring there tonight. And if you would like to go, come and join me. I'll be at the church at 6 o'clock tonight. And it's an hour service. And so we're going to pray. The pastor have been praying for the last 7 weeks on a Thursday night and for unity in our town. And this is just how we want to close it off. And it just so happens to fall on Pentecost Sunday. So that'll be happening tonight at Abundant Life Church, the 10th church at 6 o'clock. All right, so I'm going to ask you to stand again, and just as I hand over to Michael, just remember that we don't preach big sermons on tithes and offerings, but because we know that God looks at your heart, and this is really between you and Him. And if you would like to bring your tithes and offerings to the front during the next song, we invite you to do that. Thank you. Thanks, Michael.
We change the key to C, please, and can I have the next scripture? Let you stand as we read together. And after further threats, they let them go. They could not decide how to punish them because all the people were praising God for what had happened. For the man who was miraculously healed was over 40 years old. And on their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, you have made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them. And you spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant David, our father. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth take their stands and the rulers gather together against the Lord and against His anointed one. For indeed Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in the city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. And they did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. So now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with greater boldness. Stretch out your hands to heal and perform miraculous signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. And after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spoke the word of God boldly. Lord, there's a table you prepared for me in the presence of my enemies. It's your body, the blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battle. For what you've done. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how. On my knees in the valley, I know that you're with me. Surely your goodness and your mercy follow me. my weapons, praise and thanksgiving. This is how I fight my battle. Hey! And I believe you overcome, and I will lift my song of praise for what you've done. This is how I fight my battle. This is how I fight my battle. This is how I fight my battle. This is how. I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, yeah. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, Lord. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. So remember that scripture in Revelation says that the bride was encamped in Jerusalem, and all around her were the enemies, and they had surrounded her, and there looked to be no hope. But the Lord spoke a word out of heaven, and the battle belonged to the Lord, and he destroyed them all. And she did nothing but stand and trust him. She did nothing but stand and trust him and worship at what he had done. Hey!
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, Lord. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Your grace covers me. Hey, hey, hey. Your grace covers me. Hey. Your grace covers me like a blanket, Lord. Your grace covers me.
You are my firm foundation. You are my hiding place. You are my fortress. You are my rock. I hide myself in you. I'll testify of the battles you've won. You were my portion when there wasn't enough. I'll testify of the seas that we've crossed, the waters you parted, Lord, the waves that we walked. Singing, oh, my God did not fail. Oh, that's the story I tell. But I know that down through the years. I look on this moment, I see your hand on it, I know you were here. And I testify of the battles you won. You were my portion when there wasn't enough. The seas that we've crossed, the waters you parted, the waves that we won, singing, oh, 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 my God did not fail. Story I'll tell. Oh, 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 I know it is well. Mm-hmm. Oh, 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 that's the story I'll tell. The leaving gets hard, Lord. Options are few, and I can't see what you're doing. I know that you're proving you're the God who comes through. Oh, but I know that over the years, I look back on this moment, I see your hand on it. I know you were here, and I'll testify of the battles you won. Oh, how you were my portion when there wasn't enough. Jesus, I'll testify of the sea. The waters you parted, the waves that we wore, are singing, oh, 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 my God did not fail. Yeah, oh, 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 that's the story I'll tell. Yeah. That's the story I'll tell. Even when it's hard, Lord. Even when it's hard, that's the story I'll tell. Even when it's hard, Lord. That's the story I'll tell. Not because we think that we can get from you by believing. Not because we think that we can manipulate you, make your hand move by pretending we feel what we don't feel. But that is the story I will tell, because I will remind myself. I will choose to remind myself what the Lord has done in my life. How he has been a refuge and a safe place. I'll remind myself of every kindness, of every gentleness, of every time in his presence when he let me know that it would be all right. When he held me like a father and I knew that it is well. I will testify I will cast all my cares upon you, and I'll lay all of my burdens down at your feet. And any time that I don't know what to do, I will cast all my cares upon you. Let's just do that now. I will cast all my cares upon you. I will lay all of my burdens down at your feet. And any time that I don't know what to do, I will cast all my cares upon you. We lay all of our anxieties at your feet, Jesus. We know we've done it before and we'll do it again. It's okay. You do not hold it against us. But we come to you again and again with our anxieties and the things that we pick up, which we should keep laid down, but we struggle. So we lay it all down before you again this morning. All of the things that we worry about, all of the cares of the week to come, all of the things that we don't want to face, all of our struggles in our homes, in our businesses, in this town. We lay them all at your feet. Let's just sing that again. I will cast. I will cast all my cares upon you. I'll lay all of my burdens down at your feet. At any time, I don't know what to do. I will cast all my cares on you. All my anxiety, all insecurity, give you my vanity. I lay it at your feet, all my anxiety, my insecurity, all my vanity. 'Cause you're my reward, you're my reward, all my anxiety, all insecurity, I give you my vanity. Your feet, all my anxiety, my insecurity, oh, my vanity, 'cause you're my reward, you're my lay all of my burden feet, and any time that I don't know what to do, I will cast all my cares upon you. Jesus, there's no other name. Jesus, I find my rest only in you. Jesus, I find all my rest in you. I find my rest in you. Yes, I find my rest. Yes, I find my rest in you. For you have promised that you would send the Comforter to us, and that you would be with us. They called you Emmanuel. They called you Emmanuel when you came and lived here on the earth. That you were God with us. But you are Emmanuel still by the Holy Spirit. That you are God with us. You walk with us. You are still our shepherd by the Spirit. You still walk with us beside still waters. Your rod and your staff, they still comfort us. And you are still strong and able to move in our lives. And you are still gentle and kind, and your words still heal. We cast all of our cares upon you. We find our rest in you. As we go into your word this morning, Lord Jesus, we ask that you help us to stay in rest, that we would not make ourselves anxious in response to your word, but that we would find our rest in you, because your words are truth. Your words are healing. So we come to your word eager. So your word is food for us. Your word is manna. So we come to your word eager this morning to receive, knowing that you are giving yourself to us through the word. We thank you for that. And all God's people said, amen.
Anybody want to guess what we're talking about this morning?
Holy Spirit.
Okay, you guys are lucky. Michael gave you a clue there. Holy Spirit. I think somebody there said it. Yes. Was it you, Benita? Jason, that was a thing of beauty. I don't know if you guys have ever noticed, but we don't have speakers on the stage anymore. So the worship team all gets in-ears now, which makes the only sound that you hear come from those speakers over there. And we've just, by the grace of God and some expert help, we've really upgraded. Am I too loud? I feel like I can't get too loud, but either that or my hearing's getting really good. Maybe I got healing the ears of a five-year-old now. Yeah, let's just pray. Father, as we get into your word this morning, spoken by your Holy Spirit, as we look at some things this morning, Holy Spirit, we're going to be talking about you this morning. And we never want to cheapen you, Holy Spirit. We never want to try sell you, Holy Spirit. We never want to just use you for our own gain whenever we want. And just as we look at Scripture this morning, Holy Spirit, I really pray that you would lead and guide me. If anything, as we talk about you this morning, I pray that there would be a desire in each of us to get to know you better. Yes, so Holy Spirit, would you speak through me this morning? Amen. Have you ever gone to your Bible and tried to find scriptures on the Spirit of God, and seen how many scriptures there are? So I started to write some down this week and just got tons and tons and tons and tons of them and realized that I can't read them all in church and have to try and narrow this down. And I realized this morning that I still don't even have it narrowed down. So I'm really just going to trust that the Holy Spirit's going to give me a word for us this morning. And you can ask my family, it's not for a lack of prep. It's just, you know, when you speak about the Holy Spirit, you really just, like I said in my prayer, you don't want to cheapen it. And, you know, the Holy Spirit, it's not a thing of, hey, guys, come to the front. We're going to pray for the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And we all pray and people fall over. Some people laugh. Some people get tingly. And then we all just go home. And, wow, I got filled by the Holy Spirit. Cool. Let me carry on with life. There's something more. There's something more special about the Holy Spirit, and if anything, that's what I'd like to try and talk about this morning. And so there's so many scriptures, but I want to start on the one that you probably all would have guessed that I would read. And Michael, did you read this one today on the day of Pentecost, or was that Friday night? Friday night. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together. Let me use my glasses. In one place, suddenly there was the sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared on each of them, and everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. At that time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. When they heard the loud noise, everyone came running, and they were bewildered to hear their own language being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed. How can this be? They exclaimed. These people are all from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our own native tongues. Here we are, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, people from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, the province of Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the areas of Libya around Cyrene. Visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. And all these people speaking in our own language. What wonderful things has God done? They stood there amazed and perplexed. What can this mean? They asked each other. But others in the crowd ridiculed them, saying, they're just drunk, that's all. Then Peter stepped forward with the 11 other apostles and shouted to the crowd, listen carefully, all of you, you fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem, make no mistake about this. These people are not drunk, as some of you are assuming. 9 o'clock in the morning is much too early for that. No, what you see was predicted long ago by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. You young men will see visions and dreams. Will see visions, and old men will dream dreams. In those days, I will pour out my spirit even on my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy. I will cause wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and clouds of smoke. The sun will become dark, the moon will turn blood red before the great and glorious day of the Lord arrives. But everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. If I think of that scripture, and I was just reading it this week because I thought how appropriate for us to talk about that this Sunday morning, because they were all gathered in one place, okay? And if you go read the beginning of Acts, I don't think that they sat in the room for 10 days waiting for the Holy Spirit. I believe Jesus said to them, go to Jerusalem and wait for the one I am sending. And where is that scripture? Let me just use my Bible, yeah? Sometimes it's easier to find it on your Bible. Thanks for waiting so patiently. He said to them, on one occasion while he was eating with them, he gave them this command. It was a command. Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And then he said to them, verse 8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And I wonder what it was like for these guys, because they were like Galileans. I wonder if they had traveled as much as they had before they met Jesus. You know, but Jesus comes along and they're suddenly going all over the place. But Jesus told him to stay in Jerusalem and wait. You will see in that time they even chose the other apostle to replace Judas Iscariot. So they got down to a little bit of business, but they were waiting in Jerusalem. And I'm telling you now, they would not have left Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit came. And I always assumed that they just didn't know what was coming. But they did, because it's not a what, it's a he. It's he, the Holy Spirit. They knew the Holy Spirit was coming. They knew things about the Holy Spirit already, because it wasn't their first time hearing about the Holy Spirit. They weren't expecting a lucky packet and to open it up and, oh, so he comforts us, so he guides us, he illuminates the scripture to us. They knew all these things already. In fact, the disciples, the apostles, they knew what the Holy Spirit does in somebody's life because they were there when Jesus was baptized and the Holy Spirit descended on him like a dove. They saw when Jesus came out the desert, he was empowered with the Holy Spirit. He did things he hadn't done before. You see, when Jesus came to earth, he was a man just like you and me. Hey? He didn't have superpowers. If he had superpowers, he couldn't relate to us. It would be like Superman trying to explain to us pain. He's like, no, he just doesn't feel it. So the bullet bounces off. I don't know what it's like to be shot. Jesus relates to us. He was tempted in every way. Scripture tells us that he knows what we go through. But he received the Holy Spirit. And it's because he received the Holy Spirit that he did the things he did. And we get the Holy Spirit too. So the disciples had seen Jesus' life. They knew that he walked in the Spirit. He was empowered with the Spirit of God. And here's the thing, when it comes to the Spirit of God, so often we think of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Hey? The Holy Spirit's in third place. Hey? He's not as cool as the Father or Jesus. The Holy Spirit is here. But actually, God is one. So it's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And they're one. So don't ever think of the Holy Spirit as just, shame, he's on earth while the rest are in heaven. It's not like that. The Holy Spirit is God. And it's God's Spirit that comes into us. The same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead lives in us. When I gave my life to Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit came to live in me. So some people are wondering, when do we receive the Holy Spirit? When you commit your life to Jesus Christ, you receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit comes and dwells in you because now you are a temple he can dwell in. I believe the Holy Spirit walks with everybody on earth because he's omnipresent, he's God. I believe it's the Holy Spirit that pulled me to the front of the church that morning, that evening when I gave my life to Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit speaks the words that are on the Father's heart. So when I felt this, heard this voice, by the way, the old men will dream dreams. I had this dream the other day. Maybe somebody can interpret it. I've shared it with a few people. I was talking to a lady that I don't know, still don't know her, don't remember her face or anything. While I was talking to her, a donkey came and whispered in her ear. And I figured in my dream, if a donkey whispers in somebody's ear, I want to know what that donkey said, you know, because I remembered the story in my dream. I was kind of like, and he said to, and I, so I begged her to tell me. Tell me what he said. No, she said, oh, tell me what he said. He said, just, don't just be still, is what. And so that morning I woke up and I realized, I have to talk. I have to talk about God. Can't just, oh, I'm in his presence, it's just me and you, Jesus. I have to tell. And it would be like us telling the world about the Holy Spirit, who we know him to be, our friend, hey? We can't just be still about it and enjoy the Holy Spirit. Man, I often tell people how cool my wife is. My wife is not just my wife, she's my friend as well. And I get to know Kristen, and if I want to know Kristen really well, I have to spend time with her. And I ask her things, and she asks me things. And between us, there's absolute honesty, hey? So she said, did the food taste good? No, I'm joking. I'm wise. I always say it tastes good. But we're friends. We're friends first. And I often tell people about my wife, what I know about her, the cool things about my wife. And it's almost the same with the Holy Spirit. Not almost the same, it's the same with the Holy Spirit. I have a relationship with him. He wants to fellowship with us. Did you know that, church? He wants to fellowship with you and I. So put up, is it 2 Corinthians 13, verse 14? I think we put that one up yesterday. That's how we started our service yesterday. But the Holy Spirit wants to have fellowship with you. And that's why I say we can't just come here today and have this line and pray for people and we're all like, oh, cool, I got my goosebumps, I fell over, I started laughing, I started speaking in tongues, and we go off and we just carry on our life as normal. Because actually the Holy Spirit wants to go with us. You know that you can take the Holy Spirit with you to work? Hey? You can take him with you to work. And I think it's actually a pretty wise thing to do, because when you have those quiet moments, you can be like, hey, Holy Spirit, what did you... Got a word for that guy? Do you think, is there anything we should do here today? Holy Spirit, I'm really battling with this. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you always. Be with you all. I added always. But the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And that fellowship doesn't just happen here in church. You could only fellowship with me in church this morning. If you walked out that door and didn't climb into the same car as me, we can't fellowship anymore. We can only fellowship when we're face to face, but the Holy Spirit is omnipresent, and he fellowships, so he wants to fellowship with us all the time. New for some of you, maybe I need to repeat that, but the Holy Spirit wants to fellowship with you all the time. So the disciples, they're waiting in Jerusalem. Jesus just blew their minds, okay? Just like he blows our minds sometimes. He just said to them, wait in Jerusalem, you will receive power, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Can you imagine the ends of the earth for them? I don't think they had little globes like we have in our house where they could spin it and look what's on the other side of the world. And when Jesus said, and you will be my witnesses to the ends of the earth, I bet those guys were like, oh my goodness, we definitely need help. We are waiting here in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit comes, because without him, there's no ways we get this job done. And I want to tell you the same, church. In our little town, we believe God has called us to reach 100,000 people. Can I tell you that God is not going to use the pastors, and he's not going to use lukewarm believers to reach 100,000 people? But it's only those who fellowship with the Holy Spirit, that are filled with the Holy Spirit every single day, have a fresh infilling of the Holy Spirit, that have been baptized in the Holy Spirit, that walk out in that power of the Holy Spirit. That's what's going to change. So once again, we get back to, we could have that line again today, and that would be really, really easy, wouldn't it? But actually, you need to fellowship with the Holy Spirit. You are the one who needs to fellowship with the Holy Spirit. We have this book that we read every now and then. I've read a couple of them. It's called God's Generals. Okay? And it's a book about people that we all know. Smith, or we don't know personally, but we've read about them. We've heard their names. Charles Finney and Smith Wigglesworth and Catherine Kuhlman. All those people. Do you know that they had personal relationships with the Holy Spirit? They fellowshipped with the Holy Spirit. And I can tell you now that they didn't just fellowship with the Holy Spirit on a Sunday morning or Wednesday night cell group. They did not switch him on and switch him off when they didn't need him. I can't do that with my wife, who's my friend. I cannot switch her off when I don't need her. Because we have chosen to fellowship with each other until one of us goes, or we both go, or Jesus comes. But we've chosen to fellowship, and it's the same with the Holy Spirit. We choose to fellowship with Him. I choose to walk with you, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, I'm so glad you're living inside of me. Would you come and baptize me in your with your power? Would you come? May I be baptized in you, Holy Spirit. May you fill me from the top of my head to my toes with everything I need to be able to do what God has called me to do. But without you, Holy Spirit, I will not be able to do it. And I've noticed that in my life and ministry. And if I have to just be really, really honest, the times that I am burnt out in ministry is the times that I've been so busy that I haven't spent time in His presence, that I haven't fellowshipped with Him. Because then guess what happens when I'm not fellowshipping with Him? I'm doing it in my strength. And my strength will only take me so far, and then I get burnt out. But sometimes I have to just switch off the world. If I switch my phone off, people get upset with me. Okay, it just happens in ministry. And you know, the pastor, if he switches off his phone, because that guy's almost like Superman, which isn't true, because we all receive the same Holy Spirit. But sometimes I just need to switch off and spend time with God. I'm not so good at it, so I have a few people that hold me accountable to that in my life, and I won't look in any directions. But there are a few people that make sure that I spend time in the Holy Spirit with God, that I rest. Jesus taught his disciples that the Holy Spirit would dwell in them. He dwells in us. He teaches us all things. So you don't have to put these scriptures up, but John 14:17, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it sees him not, neither knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and shall be in you. And there was a point where Jesus breathed on them, the disciples. I think it's John 20:22. He breathed on them and he said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. Up until that point, the disciples hadn't received the Holy Spirit. And he breathed on them, and then he said, now he dwells in you. He teaches us all things. John 14:26, but the Comforter, who is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, shall teach you all things They knew who was coming. He will bring remembrance of all things Jesus said. This was a very important story Jesus had, and he wanted everybody to remember it. But the Comforter is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, shall teach you all things and bring all things to remembrance, whatsoever I've said to you. He will testify about Jesus. He will convict the world of sin, righteousness, and judgment. He will guide us in all truth. He will tell us of things to come, and he will glorify Jesus. And this is one thing I just want to say about the Holy Spirit this morning, because really just battling to say all there is about the Holy Spirit this morning. But if I can finish with this, it excites me that the disciples knew who was coming, and we know who the Holy Spirit is. We know that we need him just as much as the disciples needed him. But the Holy Spirit isn't he's a person. And he wants to fellowship with you. And just like I can hurt you, you can hurt the Holy Spirit. Scripture says, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. The other word it says is, do not quench the Holy Spirit. We do not take the Holy Spirit for granted, church. Here's the thing that we sit with, because we mention it so often in church, and I know I especially do, because this is something that I have to constantly think of, because this is my the way I can check my life. But you're either in the world or you're with God. You're either for God or you're against God. There's a line that's drawn in the sand, and there's no gray area. So when it comes to Galatians 5, and it talks about the fruit of the Spirit, that is the fruit of the Spirit. But before that, it goes and talks about the fruit of the world. And you cannot have of either. You cannot. The world will probably be okay with you having a little bit of the world and a little bit of the Holy Spirit, but that's not good enough for God. God says you choose me or you choose the world, but you cannot do both. So some of the things that are mentioned in Galatians 5, if we can get a little bit real here this morning. And I only talk about this because I know in my life I have quenched the Holy Spirit. I know in my life I have grieved the Holy Spirit. Galatians 5:13 says, the heading in my Bible is Life by the Spirit, which caught my eye. And it says, my brothers and sisters, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But do not use your freedom to indulge in the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command, love your neighbor as you love yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, you will be destroyed by each other. So I say to you, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Does that sound like good news? So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. So if I want to be good friends with Kristen, okay, I cannot do things constantly that she doesn't like. And she can't do things that I don't like. Because we would push each other away, hey? So how can we indulge in the world yet still want to have fellowship with the Holy Spirit? Because then surely we're switching him on and off. So you have to make this choice. And it's not a very difficult choice. I'm not saying to you, fight temptation in your life, overcome temptation. I'm just saying what Scripture says here, and it says, I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. So you choose today to have the Holy Spirit walk with you, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Because I know the Holy Spirit. I know Kristen, so I'm not going to do things that she doesn't like. Because it's just going to irritate her and she's going to want to be in another room. And I actually want her next to me. I want the Holy Spirit next to me. I need the Holy Spirit next to me. So I choose to have him here. And because he's here, I will not gratify the desires of my flesh. Because firstly, he convicts us. Hey, he probably like Sheldon. Stay away from there. Don't do that. Don't do that. It sounds bossy, but... but I'm also starting to have the fruit of the Spirit in my life. The Holy Spirit will teach you how to love, man. The Holy Spirit will teach you how to pray for people you don't like. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. See, that's that part where I'm saying you don't have to fight this thing anymore. If you are in the Spirit, you are not. If you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambitions, dissensions, factions, and envy and drunkenness. And the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will inherit, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And against such things there is no law. You can see what the world is full of right now. And you can see what the world needs more of, hey? So I choose to walk in the Holy Spirit. I choose to walk with Him daily. I do not want to grieve the Holy Spirit. I do not want to quench the Holy Spirit. I don't want to choose those things that push Him away. The other thing that quenches the Holy Spirit is an unwilling spirit. And we can all relate to this. It's that time that the Holy Spirit has said something to you. Do this maybe, or leads you in a direction and you just do the opposite. Or you don't stand up in church and give that word, or you don't go pray for that person. So even in preparing this message this weekend, I was praying, Holy Spirit, forgive me for quenching you. Forgive me for grieving you. Forgive me for having an unwilling spirit. Forgive me for the times that I've chosen the world or the things of the world because they're easier than you. I'm telling you, it's easier to go with the stream, hey? It's a lot harder to go upstream because there's so few people going upstream, you don't know how to do it. But the Holy Spirit will take you upstream. Just walk with Him. He'll tell you more than we can tell you in church on a Sunday. He illuminates Scripture to you. You open your Bible this week, you say, Holy Spirit, teach me. If He doesn't teach you this week, when you open the Word of God, there's a money-back guarantee on it. Okay, the money you paid for your Bible, I'll give it back to you personally. Okay, all right. That's how confident I am. That the Holy Spirit will teach you. So I'm going to ask the worship team to come up this morning again. I'm going to ask them, they're going to play a few songs. We're just going to be quiet here. You can pull a chair closer to you, and you can say, Holy Spirit, would you come and sit next to me? It's hard for you to sit next to me because you dwell in me, but you know what I'm saying. And just talk to the Holy Spirit. Talk to Him about the things you're battling with. Talk to Him about the things you'd like to get better at. Tell Him that you want to hear Him more clearly. Because that's what I've been saying. I'm saying, God, oh, Holy Spirit, I feel the world pulls me so much sometimes. Could you be louder in my ear than the world? But I don't want to miss out on my fellowship with you. I don't want to push you away. So we're not going to sit here for 10 days. But I'm going to give you an opportunity to just spend some time with the Holy Spirit, to have communion with the Holy Spirit, And this is why we have the communion elements here today, because the bread represents the body of Christ that was broken for us, and the cup, his blood that was shed for us, and we now live in a new covenant with him. And I believe this promise, Jesus reminds us of the promise of his promises. And one of his promises is that if he goes to the Father, the Holy Spirit will come and we will receive the Holy Spirit. So we're going to thank Jesus for his promises. And we're going to thank him for the Holy Spirit. And you can break bread with the Holy Spirit yourself. I know it sounds weird, but you can have communion with the Holy Spirit. I was at a men's camp a couple of weekends ago, and the guy was said he made coffee to meet a friend on the road, but then the friend phoned him and said, I can't meet you on the road anymore because I'm at a meeting. And he was like, oh, he was really looking forward to the fellowship, and he just felt Jesus said, I'll have coffee with you. So he pulled off on the side of the road, made two cups of coffee with the Holy Spirit, just chatted. Holy Spirit, we welcome you in this place this morning. And Holy Spirit, sometimes it just doesn't work in our minds, this whole thing that we can have fellowship with you, God. We can have fellowship with you right now. We can talk to you as if we are talking to a friend. We can tell you what's on our hearts, and you will tell us on what's on your heart. And that we'll actually hear you speak to us. It blows our minds. But I pray, Lord, that our minds would just be shut off in this moment. And Holy Spirit, I pray that you would come and fellowship with us. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you'd even come and fellowship with those who still have a really big decision to make. Am I going to completely let go of the world and just dive in and get to know the Holy Spirit as my friend? Would you speak to them, Holy Spirit? We need more of you, Holy Spirit. We want a fresh infilling of you, Holy Spirit. We want you to empower us with this beautiful message, the good news of Jesus Christ, so that we can witness that to this world, a lost and dying world that is just contrary to you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. We pray this in Jesus' name. Right, so spend some time with the Holy Spirit. We're going to ask that worship team to just lead us in worship. You can stand, sit, talk to him. You can come and help yourself. There's communion elements here and on this side of here behind the pillar, so you can help yourselves. Thank you.
We are
standing in your glory. You are here. You are holy. We are standing in your glory, Lord. You come to be hope to this world. Your honor and name, you've come to take sin, to bear shame, to conquer the grave. Oh, Emmanuel, God with us, our deliverer, you are Savior. In your presence we find our strength. Over everything, our redemption, you God with us. You are God with us. So you're here. You are here. You are holy. We are standing in your glory. You are here. You are holy. We are standing in your glory, Lord. Oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the night to die. I couldn't earn it. I don't deserve it. Still, you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. It's what you are, Holy Spirit. You're the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Before I spoke a word,